Hey guys, my fellow classmates. So as you can see, I'm still stuck in Quebec, but I'm gonna try and do this video presentation here for you guys today in lieu of my absence, I guess we'll say. So I'm gonna try and do this in one go because I do not have the movie editing skills to make this a really grand performance. So we are talking about Gail Jones's Sorry today. I'm gonna just trust and assume that everybody has read the entire novel, or at least, excuse me, most of it for, oh, excuse me, for today. yeah, so I guess we'll go right into it. So, sorry if you haven't read it all, but there's gonna be a few spoilers. So just a quick recap. So the beginning of the story open, or Gail Jones' novel opens, and it's describing Nicholas, her father, and it later moves on to Stella, her mother, and how the two of them meet. And I found it really interesting that after describing the kind of character that Nicholas was, World War I veteran whose ambitions of being a famous anthropologist they remain unfilled due to his inability to stay focused on his own ambitions. And I found the characterization of Nicholas to be really sort of symptomatic, but an individual example of the book at large and the themes of the book. The novel itself has a lack of focus, and I believe that it between the individual parts, it juxtaposes war imagery with Perdita, which is Nicholas and Stella's daughter, as you guys should know, of her deprived upbringing, because she throughout the novel, it's absolutely evident that she's neglected by both her mom and her dad. Nicholas is an absolutely staunchy, mean, rugged character who's completely selfish and only focused on his own goals, not making any sacrifices for Perdita. I can think of one instance in the novel that her the mother Stella falls ill to malaise. I'm pronouncing that right, by the way, Dr. Martin. And so she's in hospital, so there's nobody at home to take care of Perdita. So rather than stepping up, Nicholas would bring in one of the Aboriginal girls that he's studying. So you literally bring in a people that he's studying and a person who doesn't really know to take care of his own child rather than step up and raise her himself. Which is obviously a complete lack of responsibility, but I believe it shows which, leading to the thesis, it shows a fragmented view of himself and society at large, at least the society that existed within this settler frontier. Sorry, it's like really late here, so whenever I hear a siren or whatever, it's. It comes across quite loudly. Anyways, it comes across. It comes across as very fragmented, which, as I said previously, the novel comes across as very fragmented. So, what I'm proposing for this novel, which is in concert with the reading. For this week, which was Chris Eagle's his Stuttering Violence and the Politics of Voice in Robert Graves, Philip Roth, and Gail Jones. So what I'm saying is that there's the constant use of language and I would say the didacticism of the plot helps us understand the world as through Perdita's narrative as for instance, a camera, telephone, or cinema that help us understand the world as both coherent and utterly fragmented. And my opinion or thought in this book, and I'd love to hear your guys' as well, so please feel free to stop the video when I give you the cues to discuss my questions. Since I can't hear you, or can I? No, I can't. That's creepy. I'd love to hear what you guys have to say, so I'll be asking Dr. Martin sort of your guys' opinions that really come through. Hopefully they're in line with mine, but if they're not, well, you're probably right. So going forward, yeah, and I found that there was actually a quote that really mirrors what I'm saying about how we view the world, and we can view this book and the narratives in this book sort of telescopically through a lens of some sort, that we aren't seeing a true representation of reality. We're seeing the representation of that representation of reality. So it's on page 103, so it's just at the beginning of chapter 10. And I'll read it for you guys here. The day unveils itself in partial scenes and stages, as if a memory camera is fixed and cannot swing around to envision the entire room or every one of the players. So for me, that quote was really, it really summed up sort of what I'm driving at for this book, that it's a very fragmented series of narratives, events, really disturbing, as we find out, psychological and physical instances, which would be Nicholas's death. Sorry for you guys who haven't read this far in the book yet, or hopefully all of you guys have, so really know what I'm talking about here. But the didacticism and the way the book was written itself, I found it to be kind of postmodern. A really great parallel would sort of be In the Skin of a Lion by, who's that by? Michael Ondaatje. How it seems like one chapter to the next, a story doesn't flow. Like one chapter doesn't connect to the second chapter, but the narrative from chapter one might be in sync with chapter five. But, you know, a lot happens in between there. So that feeling of fragmentation throughout the novel, I found it really deliberate, and we can read into all sorts of instances, and I think, well, especially moments in the book, but it's really easy to connect to the overarching themes or make connections to what we don't yet understand. And what I believe that to be is sort of the psychological effects of a stammer or this fluency. So, yeah, like I said, so the book is, it's written in a style that really encapsulates the loneliness of both the setting, the Australian frontier, so really, really sparsely populated. These Aboriginal groups, they're located within very specific areas, and the settlers and anthropologists like Nicholas, they would be pretty well on their own. So it would be really hard for Perdita or Nicholas or Stella to find someone who they relate to. So both the loneliness of the setting and Perdita's hapless childhood. So in line with that as well, I mean, I couldn't really discern. I'd love to hear what you guys have to say. Did you think this was the story of a girl with a stutter, or a neglected child, or the discrimination of Aboriginal people? So you can stop the video at this point, and I'd just love to see what you guys have to say about what you actually thought the book was about. Like, granted that we are in a class about disfluency, but what really came through to you guys about what's one of the major themes of this book? So you can go ahead and pause the video, and I'd love to hear what you guys think. All done? Okay, perfect. So moving forward with that theme of not being a unified whole, I also found that the book, I say this in a bit of a jaded context because I think the book wasn't long enough to really finish anything that it started. Was this an allegory of the condition of someone who suffers with a stammer? Like, does the fragmentation and not being able to finish anything, having sparse, quick, rapid ideas, but never finishing that, is that the psychological state of someone who stammers? Is it merely the physical manifestation of that? Or is it completely just a fundamental physical inability to sort of translate tones into words, right? So is this a biological problem or is this a psychological problem? And I just, before we go too much further, I want to give you guys a bit more background on Perdita's parents. So Nicholas, he's the anthropologist, right? Very self-determined, you could argue pragmatic, but completely uncommitted. He can't stay focused. And that couples with the themes. And now Stella, she's no better. Now, while she's not as outrightly abusive to Perdita, she is like absolutely incremental in the failure that was raising Perdita, I find, because of just how incomplete and inconsistent she was as a mother figure throughout the novel. And the primary job that we find Stella actually doing in Perdita's life is educating her. So they read together, and Stella was absolutely, absolutely obsessed with Shakespeare. And so, while Perdita said one of her favorite things was reading Shakespeare, you can't have a well-rounded education from Shakespeare. So I find it really just interesting and like a complete postmodernist novel where the amount of connections that you can draw from just every little bit of the book. I mean, Shakespeare, so she'll be well-versed in double-speak, double-meaning, literary devices, things that seem like one thing but mean another. And that further emphasizes the fragmentation of this novel. Does it stand for one thing and mean another, or is it just presented as it is, not meaning anything, but just a collection of half-truths? I'm not gonna lie, after finishing the novel, I was very unsatisfied. I absolutely didn't feel like anything was finished. To go a bit further into the background of Nicholas and Stella, was their marriage, even from the very beginning. The novel says, they met each other, and I believe I'm quoting, that Nicholas wasn't, he was something that was slightly attractive, but he was a known quantity to Stella. And likewise to Nicholas, Stella was someone that knew would admire him for all that he had to promise but couldn't follow through with. So it really seemed like it was a hapless marriage that created a hopeless child who lived a hapless life. Sorry for all the H's. But even from the beginning, like, you don't really get a sense that they love each other. It's just that there is a mere sort of interest or attraction to each other, but it never really confounded into anything. I'd love to find that quote for you guys here. Sorry, you guys can pause the video while I find the quote so you're not waiting for too long. She knew that he had been wounded in the war and was shy and vulnerable. He would be flattered, she thought, if she agreed to walk out with him. In this oscillation of estimations, both somehow converged and agreed almost without discussion. So, an unspoken, unknown really interaction between the two of them. It was something like, again, that you can't really explain. One thing that seemed like one thing but meant another. I mean, you can boil it down to like the basic body language that you might use when interacting with somebody at the store, or for us youngins, maybe you go to the bar. I wouldn't know anything about that. And, you know, the sort of flirtatious, intimate body language that you might use with somebody. And that's like sort of the sense that I got here. But that turned into a marriage based on nothing really besides that. And on their second meeting, and this is on page 18, by the way, guys. On their second meeting, she wore her very best hat, a cloche, in gray felt adorned by a peacock feather eye, but realized that Nicholas seemed not to notice at all. So, right from the beginning, like, he's not focused at her at all. All he can focus on is being wrapped up in his world and his hopes and admirations that never turn into anything, which is really frustrating for the reader. And to see, it's like, well, Stella, why would you still stay with this guy? And it almost is interesting to think, is Nicholas the manifestation of these ideas of fragmentation and isolation and just bad things happening again and again and again? Or is Perdita, the daughter, is she the manifestation of a hapless childhood? And moving forward, so one of the things that I found rather interesting here was, again, a spoiler alert, this is closer towards the end of the novel for you guys, that, well, actually, no, I'll skip to the part ahead of that, the part where Perdita get, like, she has the psychological event, we'll say, and she acquires her stammer. So this is an incident with Mary, who has quite an unfortunate series of experiences with Nicholas already up to this point. She's been sexually abused by Nicholas, and later it's quoted in the book that it was Mrs. Trevor. She never expected that from Nicholas. And she sent away my best damn cook for nothing, with child. So nobody expected this out of Nicholas, but really, I think as the reader in the audience, you're not surprised by it just because of how self-interested and self-motivating and how much this character lacks a moral compass. I don't think we're really surprised, by his actions here at all, or at least I'm not. But moving forward, so Perdita comes to a point where she kills her father, she slits his throat, and Mary ends up taking the blame for this, which that instance right there, I think, fits really well into this theme of imagery, of the representations, like seeing through a camera lens. That I mentioned before. Is this just another example of the Aboriginal victim playing the victim? But the settler, or the, it would be the settler, is the harmed one. So is the narrative such that Perdita is sort of the consequence of this narrative, or is Mary, does she follow sort of the classical Aboriginal victim narrative? And you can read them both from either way, but upon closer reading, you see that it's kind of not really so. I found that Mary was actually the most consistent character it is, and she's almost a heroine. She's a hero to Perdita, and she's only one of two characters that I think functions as a lens to Perdita. So both herself, so Mary, functions in this way, And similarly, so does Billy. That's it. That's yes, the deaf mute boy. So he works in a he functions in a slightly separate way, where Mary empowers and she builds on Perdita in Stella's absence. She's like the most stable maternal figure that Perdita has to hold on to, and unfortunately, she loses her. Because she takes the blame for Nicholas's death. But following that, the deaf mute boy Billy, he through like through Perdita, she gains agency through him because he's really unable to communicate his thoughts, his feelings. It's said that when he gets really anxious or upset, he starts flapping his arms uncontrollably. And like it's like a bird trying to take off. And yet they become fast friends because through Billy, she gains agency in her own life. And that's a really interesting sort of dynamic I found. Even following someone who has a stammer. And I haven't looked into any additional research, but I'd be interested to see what you guys think. Because I think trying to speak through somebody else, it fits in with this theme of lenses, like perspectives, that Perdita would be communicating through the lens or through the facility of Billy, because it's well, he's physically unable as he's a mute, but in giving her agency. It sort of gives her like a brief moment of success, a brief moment of happiness, a brief moment of self-agency that she does not have long term throughout the novel. And this is one of the things that I found so unsatisfying, was that she has it for a moment and then she loses it. And the moment that really sort of set it off for me was when she goes to Dr. Oblov to cure her stutter. And he cures her stammer, but in doing so, he unearths the truth of what happened to her father's death. And upon doing so, no significant events really take place. I mean, he finds out what happened to Nicholas. Doesn't see like in retrospect of the novel, doesn't seem to be bothered at all by it because he just sort of vanishes. And that's the thing, that all these characters just sort of vanish into an oblivion of sorts. After this, this sort of denouement, this moment of happening occurs, you'd think that everything would start to fall in place for her, but it doesn't really. Everyone just sort of disappears. And I'd like you guys to stop the video again. Just at this point, and let me know, or let Dr. Martin know, just what did you think of this sort of revelation where she cured her stammer by Dr. Oblov? Did you find it just or satisfying, or was it really unjust and an unsavory moment for you in the long run? So go ahead and pause and then play back when you're done, and I'll let you know what I think. All good to go, guys? So for me, I found that this was incredibly unsatisfying, as I briefly said before. Just as I said, because everybody fades away, and what the heck? This is supposed to be a moment of jubilee for her. She like everything should go uphill, but it seems to follow that what you want to happen in the story continually doesn't happen. It's a really depressing novel. And Perdita is completely left alone with no definitive sense of direction at the conclusion of the novel. And I just, like, what the heck? I think it really speaks to the fragmentation of Gail Jones's novel, that this would happen. And moreover, reverting back to a second here about the constant use of language that I was talking about, speaking through representations and through filters, I thought it would be quite interesting to note that as I'm speaking to you about representations and images and cameras, you guys are hearing it from me through a video which was recorded by a camera. There's your guys' meta moment for the day. So you're hearing representations from a representation about a representation. Representing a representation. I don't think I've gone too far with that. But I just thought that might be a bit of a ironic moment. And like I said, it fits in great with the novel. So in addition to what I've been previously speaking about in regards to representations, there's also the significance of trauma throughout this book. Physical trauma, emotional trauma, psychological trauma, we want to say, is Dr. Oblov characterizes it towards the end of the novel. And the most significant scene in that would be Perdita's father's death, Nicholas, as it, and I'm quoting here on, this is page 135, guys, returns and returns, unsettled, mutable, fraught with the abstraction of trauma and the shattering of time. So, again, the fragmented actual style of writing with this book and the specific use of language that goes with it. The abstraction of trauma, the shattering of time, the breaking down of these barriers. Oh god, you know what? I'm sorry guys, I just know Dr. Martin's gonna get really Freudian with you guys, so I apologize in advance, but it's good. You didn't hear me say that. And so like the shattering of time. There's a deconstruction of these almost rational, but known moral fixated barriers in narrative, like not just storytelling, but reality. And Perdita's reality is so fragmented from her life, her childhood growing up, and just everything that's just been poisoned and hasn't come through for her. Moreover, like the writing of this book, it's so fragmented that like it just keeps coming back to this theme, back to this theme, back to this theme. And the importance of trauma from this one scene is really significant, like monumental to this theme throughout the book as a whole. I have another quote for you guys about the force of the non-experience. So there's the experience and the non-experience. Like, again, it just keeps coming back together. And it said on page 7, it says, Carruth claims is registered in the, quote, collapse of its understanding. So, like, Nicholas's tormented daughter had, in fact, reached for the knife that killed her father when she saw him having sexual relations with Mary. But she can't recall killing her father. And when she saw him having these sexual relations, it was quoted on 147 in the novel, guys. And it says, quote, she was witness and not the witness. So, again, you have that fragmented reality where, you know, is she viewing this in reality? Or is she representing a reality through a lens of what she wants to believe? So it can get really philosophical here, guys, really quick. Is your reality reality, or is the only reality that's true your perceived reality? You know, depending how far you want to go into that, but let's try not to slip in that, because this is only supposed to be like a 30 to 45 minute presentation, and I would hate to take up the entire seminar because the conversation skewed off into philosophical debate. But anyways, moving on. But yeah, so she can't make sense of that. She's the witness and not the witness. So representation versus reality. And it's completely driven by trauma. So the function of trauma sort of skews the line between these two, to where we don't know, and we almost get the sense that throughout the book, we're reading through this camera lens, rather than reading in a like an objectifiable, quantifiable reality, because like as a narrator, she's just not reliable. She's not truthful because she doesn't know what's going on. And if we look even further, going further in that quote, guys, and oh, here it is. As if a cloud has blown through her eyes and into the wind. Oh, crap. No. It's as if a cloud has blown through her eyes and into her head. And so that's on 137, guys. And like this just it keeps coming back to this theme. And if we even look at Perdita as she was named, in the beginning of the novel, it mentions that she was named after a Shakespearean character in The Winter's Tale, I think it was that they mentions. And she feels lost and unwanted by her parents and inadvertently tries to unveil the whole truth, in a sense of her own sea of blurred and ever-changing images. She just can't make sense of reality. So these lenses are effective not only for her, but the reader to gain insight into the world that Perdita is trying to navigate. So she's literally, upon birth, a representation because she's named after a character in a Shakespearean play. She's not her own self. From her conception, she was like a perspective of a perspective of something else. She was a Shakespeare character, which her mom was obsessed with. She couldn't be her own child. She didn't have parents in her life. Like, it's just the compounding realities of this book are just like, it's really depressing. Like, everybody go home and kiss your mom and dad after this presentation, after you read this book. Like, my goodness. And even moving forward, I think it's on again 137. It says, and she's struggling to see and think and stay fully awake. She wants nothing more than to fall into the oblivion of fatigue and forgetting. So she it comes to the point where this trauma continues to poison and skew her reality so much that she doesn't know. She doesn't only not want to know, but she doesn't want to sort of participate and know her own reality. So the like trauma in this book focus like it works coupled with the theme of representations, which really pushes Perdita over the edge and forces her to kill her father. And you can keep looking back at representations as a theme in this book. Sorry, in this novel, as both a unifying and coherent and utterly shattering theme. So, in regards to Mary, I know I asked you guys before, what does she represent to you? Or rather, was the story of a traumatized girl, or was this the excuse me, the narrative of a the discrimination of Aboriginal people. And I turn now to because the theme of trauma is so significant in what I'm trying to explain to you guys about representations and how they act. So I wanted to also see who you guys thought the victim of the story was. Was the victim Mary? Or did you think the victim was Perdita in this novel? Was she sort of the consequence of her parents' decision, or was Mary truly the victim of the story? So, I'm as just quickly pause and maybe just yes or no. I think she was the victim, and here's why, or I do not think she's the victim, and here's why I don't think why. And I'd love to hear what you guys have to say. So pause and let me know. All done? Awesome. Thanks, guys. So I really felt that throughout this play that Mary was, she had a split meaning, sort of, which, once again, you know, dueling perspectives there. She was both the victim, but also kind of the hero of the story. I found that she was one of the more consistent characters in the book. That she was there for Perdita, where her mother and father weren't. And moreover than that, while she causes the sort of trauma with Stella unconsequently, because Perdita, when she sees Nicholas, her dad, when she sees her father sexually abusing Mary, then she kills him. So Mary was sort of the catalyst that caused Perdita's stammer to develop, because she was sort of the, excuse me for using mannerism, but it was the straw that broke the camel's back. She was the catalyst that caused Perdita to finally take action. And upon doing so, she clearly made the wrong choice. And as a result, she suffered through the stammer. But in that, I still think that Mary is the true victim of this, because she takes the brunt of the, she takes the blame for the crime. So she's the one who comes forward and says, you know, I'm guilty. This is my fault. And Perdita just gets to keep on living her life with her mother Stella. And I have a hard time looking at Perdita as a victim, when she was really given a great gift and probably a greater self-sacrifice that Mary gave to Perdita than either of her parents had ever made in their entire lives. I absolutely cannot find another example in the book of something that her that either Stella or Nicholas gave up in such a fashion as Mary for her own well-being. So while Mary, on the one hand, she's this victim of the novel, and you can, like, aboriginals and aboriginal authors would see that through confessing to the crime, but this story can only properly be problematized by addressing the sort of social and historical context of trauma through what these aboriginal children have faced. You know, you can look at instances of through the church and religion and persecution, and even these anthropologists, I guess, and it seems that they're not safe. And this seems to be like a consistent theme that Aboriginal authors continue to tackle. One text I also know in that fits in with that theme would be, I can't remember who the author is, but it's The Plains of Paradise. I read it previously in a Canadian literature course, and it's like it completely falls into that theme of Aboriginal women and children, particularly the younger females, as these victims of sexual aggression, frustration, and violence. And, you know, on the other hand, where she's given really just an absolute hopeless situation, where she's brought in to take care of this child and she's sexually abused. And then on top of that, when her attacker is finally met with retribution, she then takes the blame for his death. So she's absolutely the victim. But I also found in another sense, she's also the hero. she's completely championed Perdita. Like, it's easy to say that, hey, you know what, this instance, like, gave her the stammer, it was psychologically disturbing, it caused her psychological problems. You know, she will never be the same. But she, Mary, gave Perdita an entirely selfless act. She sacrificed herself, as you can make the argument that many characters in Shakespeare's plays have, that Perdita's own parents failed and failed to never do for her. They never gave up anything for her. They only pushed their own selfish motives. Nicholas never really cared about his daughter because he was always busy working. There's a quote earlier in the book. He left in the early morning as if he worked a bank job or like a desk job. And her mother only taught her Shakespeare because that's all her mother was interested in. So in this sense, I really find that Mary is truly a better parent and role model and moral figure in not only the book, but to Perdita in the entire book. She really is, because she, like I said, she gives Perdita this moment of complete selflessness, and which allows her to carry on, which unfortunately, as we find out later, ends very in a very unsatisfactory kind of way. Hey guys, so just in conclusion, I hope you really liked the presentation. I hope it gave you a couple things to think about. I think it's a really great reading of this novel to consider the theme of not only perspectives, and I'm sure Freud came up or is gonna come up after this. As I said, the representations and how trauma factors into this. We also have to consider Mary and Aboriginal people and the contemporary narratives that they are writing and have been writing that factor into this, as well as the victimization of their people, and how this entire story functions as a fractured, not so much as a sense of timeline, but a thematic fracturing of this novel, and how throughout, and consistently with Gail Jones's use of language, how it plays into this sense of the fractured self, where Perdita not only feels she lacks the self, but she can't effectually navigate her environment because she has no sense of self. She can only function in these representations. And I mean, I know I gave you guys a bit of a meta moment, but it kind of makes me think in regards to disfluency as well. Is this the psychological manner of someone who stutters? Because it's something that we haven't really looked into, or it's, you know, going about how would we look into something like that? How does the psychology of someone who stammers play into this? Because I know up to this point, all the literature that we've read, there seems to be a really common trend of a psychological element to someone who stutters. So I'd love to see what you guys think about that, and can't wait to see the rest of your guys' presentations. I'll see you there next week.